Welcome to CLIMAX Academy Live. My name is Fitz Acheson and I work with CLIMAX customers in tech support, applications engineering, and training. Today I'd like to address the top five frequently asked questions related to the BW3000 bore welder. As an example, we have a couple of BW3000 bore welders set up here to reference during our time together. As usual, safety is our highest priority. We always want to do a risk assessment of the work area. It's a good habit to look around for hazards that you could come in contact with or the equipment. And it's important to look out for cords and, you know, more like trip hazards. We want to watch out for sharp objects, chips, cutting tools, pinch hazards. In the machining world, when making adjustments to the machine itself, try to remove power before doing that. And of course, always use proper PPE for the situation at hand. In the bore welding world, standard PPE applies nicely, standard welding PPE applies nicely. An alternate option is a handheld helmet with a 5-shade lens and then a pair of 3-shade safety glasses with side shields for easy viewing of the control. When combined, these two perform well for easy close-up viewing of the weld without headbutting the part if you're wearing a helmet. Anyway, now that we're comfortable with our surroundings, to submit questions related to our topic today, please submit those to Zoom Q&A at the bottom of the screen. If we don't get to your question, we'll be sure to follow up with you after this session. So, the top five frequently asked questions. One of the top ones we bump into is, why is the weld not fusing to the part? And generally, this is related to situations where bore welders are being used in the horizontal axis, and people will call up and say, one of the funny ones is, it's beer canning on me. And the answer to that is that happening on one side of the bore? And they say, yes, how did you know? And usually, that's going to be a downhand side of the bore that the puddle is actually falling ahead of the arc and it's blanketing the arc from the base metal. And so typically we can relate that to incorrectly set travel speed. And so if you have the travel speed too slow, in general, that's going to relate to a lack of fusion on the downhand. It is possible to have lack of fusion in the vertical axis, but typically that's because people run the step too short. So that's usually the reasons why we have lack of fusion to the part. We have another one that says, why do I have grapes on the uphill of my weld process? Grapes are described as like the weld is dripping on the uphand. So the weld runs out of control on the uphand and it's drooping as they go up. And in general, grapes on the uphill would be eliminated by reducing current. And current means wire speed. And so initially you'll start out at 110 or 120 amps and go up and over. And then when you've got the first bead established, then you can increase your current to a larger level afterwards. And so generally it's current that's the problem. It is possible to have excessive voltage cause grapes on the uphand, but in general it's a current problem. Reduce current, get control, reduce step obviously, and then regain control and continue on and get back up to your normal welding parameters. Another question we run into is, what shielding gas should I use while bore welding? And actually just the other day I was at a place doing a training and the guy I had called and said, do you have 7525? And he said, yeah, we've got 7525. And I showed up and the only gas they had was an argon CO2 oxygen mix, which actually is really not good for bore welding out of position. So in general, we're going to stick to a 7525 argon CO2 for out of position welding, which is the horizontal axis. And then in the vertical axis with the horizontal weld, we can run a 92.8 argon CO2. And so the argon CO2 of 92.8 will be less spatter, and then the argon CO2 of 7525 is much better for faster puddle freeze and a little bit of dig. So that's generally where we're at with bore welding. And that's with mild steel, obviously. So a whole different world when we get into exotics. Another question is, what is the max current I can weld out of position? And this is a great question because the average person's probably welding about 125 to 140 amps That's just easy. It works really well. They don't have to worry about getting out of control. In general, the max current that I weld to show people how much you can run is about 180 amps. 175, 180 is about what you can run before you get out of control going vertical up. The bore welder itself is limited to 175 amps at 100% duty cycle. So typically, we're not going to run more than that in the world of out of position welding. When you get vertical, then people start running much more current, even though the bore welder is really not set up for it. We run 175 amps as our max out of position. This is a funny question. Why is reverse rotation important? So in the vertical axis, reverse rotation doesn't really do a whole lot for us. But in the horizontal axis, if you're welding clockwise, your vertical up is on one side of the bore, and it's always a little bit more lumpy on the way uphill. It just doesn't look as nice as the vertical downside. And what ends up happening is if you try to weld in the same direction again over that pass, what you end up with is magnifying the problems that you had on the first pass. And so reversing rotation direction actually makes everything just get really, really easy. There are camps of thinking that suggest that you're going to build up more on one side than the other, but my main interest is really just making it easier to weld. So I weld one pass clockwise, next pass counterclockwise, the next pass clockwise again, and so on. And you never really have to go in there and try and remachine out, which you would do if you kept going in the same direction. We have another question that comes up fairly frequently, which is related to flux cord wire. And people suggest, ask if they can use flux cord wire. And if you have all position flux cord wire, it actually works really well. It isn't the same world as solid wire, obviously, but in some places with if there's wind or the bore is contaminated, it can actually help a lot for making things a little bit easier. The challenge is that the vertical down tends to be where things get out of control, and you still have to keep an eye on, obviously, your current, so you don't want to exceed the 175 amps. And in general, it works pretty well. So a 71T1 is actually a pretty nice wire, and you're going to run an 045. Then just keep an eye on your current and make sure you're down in the range where, which makes sense for bore welding. And you have to clear out the flux, but in the end, it's really not too bad. You can actually leave the flux in the bore and clear it out when you're done. Usually it'll get through itself. So flux cord wire for bore welding is a yes, but we have to be very specific about the type of wire. Also, it's going to be much hotter on tips and nozzles than in general. So the solid wire is probably 85 or 90% of the time people are using solid wire. So we have another question which is related to pie mode and carriage return. So pie mode and carriage return are all based off the auto skip cams on top of the bore welder. So you have these cams that originally were designed to jump the detent in the cams. Then we realized that we could weld back and forth inside the cams from 0 to 180 degrees, and that was great for welding out of round bores or fixing out of round bores. It allows us to stay in the bad section and weave back and forth and fix that section of the bore. The challenge is if you're welding in the horizontal axis and the out of round section ends up on the 9 o'clock or the 3 o'clock position of the bore, pie mode's really not so great because you have a vertical up bead which is tall and narrow, followed by a wide flat downhill bead, and then a narrow tall uphill bead. There's nothing to support the uphill bead. So carriage return was developed. The reason it's called carriage return is because of typewriters, which is actually kind of old school, right? So you weld, and then it runs back to the original starting point while stepping, and then it welds in the direction that it originally did. So you have a vertical up, vertical up, vertical up, or vertical down, vertical down, vertical down, depending on which direction you put the rotation of the bore welder in. So great function, and the only machine that does that is the BW3. We get some challenges in the field with people wanting longer conduits, and they ask why the conduits are so short on the Bortec units. And in general, the challenge is that we're rotating a head around non-rotating wire. And so the action of the wire being twisted up inside the conduit as you're rotating the machine, that wire has to unwind at some point. The shorter and shorter the conduit is, the less and less effect that will be. In other words, wire flip is a result of effectively a number of things, but conduit length is one of them. And so if you can reduce conduit length, you'll have less aggressive wire flip, and as well increasing the length of increasing the diameter of the cast of the wire, which is the relaxed state of the wire as it comes off the reel. Some wires are very cheap, they're wound very tightly and they might be like a 12-inch cast. Some wires come off the reel at 60 inches. The larger cast wire flips less. So I actually kind of combine two questions in that, because we have another question about why do I have wire flip and what can I do to avoid it. Most guys in the field, as far as heavy equipment people, don't really care too much about wire flip. But when it's aggressive, it can be really annoying if it happens on the uphill. And so if wire flip's happening on the uphill, you can simply move your wire feeder to another location and change it to a different area. In general, I'll run a C-shaped conduit, and I'll have the bore welder, wire feeder underneath the bore welder. And so the wire feeder's underneath, and the conduit is a C-shape going into it. I set this wire feeder up on its back and run a C-shape into the bore welder. That reduces flip a lot. But in general, wire straighteners can be used to straighten the wire out, but we can't really do that with the enclosed wire feeder. But if you're using a shop style wire feeder, you can straighten the wire with a wire straightener. So that's a quick overview of that. If anybody gets really deep, wants to get deeper, we can talk about it personally. Give me a yell. The last question we have is, my weld deposit is hard and I can't machine it. What did I do wrong? This doesn't happen as much these days as it used to, but it's still possible that you're welding on a casting that has more carbon in it than a low carbon steel. And so it's possible, if you don't preheat the part, that you can have the carbon come out of the base metal and get into the weld metal, and in the process of freezing, a fast puddle freeze, you end up with a hardenable deposit. The beautiful thing about bore welding is you can re-weld the bore on top of that and temper the underbead and possibly get to the point where you can actually machine that part. If the weld deposit is too hard to machine and you do a weld pass over it and you can't machine it, then at some point you're going to have to get a torch out or a rosebud or a Cooper heat or something and take the thing up to just under critical temperature, which would be the phase change between magnetic and non-magnetic. So you don't want to go over that, but you want to be just underneath. So if anybody gets into this, wants to get deeper into that subject, we'll be glad to talk to you about it in more depth. And so we have another question. It says, is clockwise and clockwise / counterclockwise direction determined looking from the torch end or the base of the welder? It's from the back of the machine. So clockwise is from the back. But that looks like what we've got for the day. If there are any more questions, please get back to us through askcpmt.com. And if you have any machines that you'd like to cover in the future, please forward them to us as well. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time.